In this video, we're going to continue looking at this simple statistical test and just build up a little bit more into the ideas of how we would put these inside a tidy framework. So we'll look specifically at how we can start from something that's in a data frame object class and work towards using these different statistical tests that require us to input a vector. So let's start again with that same idea of having a vector where we've got a random draw of 1,000 values from a normal distribution with a mean of 200 and the standard deviation of 50. And in this case, we're going to put that into a data frame. So it'll be a single column in a data frame. So let's go through, make sure that you have tidyverse loaded, and we'll also be using Broom, so load that. And then we can create that vector. We're using the rnorm function, which allows us to draw a random sample from a normal distribution. And we first say how long we want that to be, how many numbers to draw, and then the mean value is 200 and a standard deviation of 50. And then if we want, we can put that inside a data frame. So we can do this normal x data frame in this case, and we'll use tibble. And then in this case, we're just gonna have one column. So we'll do what should we call this? So right now we're calling it the norm vector. And we can just define that as this vector we just created. So when we look at it now, you'll see that we've got a tibble. It's just got one column, but it is in that tibble format in comparison to the original vector that we had where it's all in that long string of values. Now that we have it in this format, we can go through and we can use our classic ggplot function. So in the last slide, I used qplot from the ggplot2 package, and that allows you to work directly with vectors because the input data for ggplot really needs to be in a data frame. But once you've got this in a data frame, even if it's just one column, we can use all of the tools that we've learned for ggplot. So in this case, if we wanted to create a histogram, we can use ggplot. We need to put in the name of the data frame that has the data that we want to plot in it. And then we can define the aesthetics. For a histogram, you just need to do an x value. And for this, we put the column with that information. And then we can add our geom, which is a histogram for this. And we can see that creates the histogram for us. Now, the next thing to think about is how we could do this test. If you'll remember, the Shapiro-Wilkes test, the function that we used for that, requires us to input a vector. So we need to figure out a way, if we have this stored in a data frame, to pull something out as a vector. There's a great function you can use for that from dplyr that does just what you're looking for. It's called the pull function. So we can take this data frame that we've created. And if we want to pull out one of its columns as a vector, we can use pull and then the column name. That was norm vector. You can see that that's pulled it back out as a vector. We're back to that vector class where we can put it in the different statistical test. So now we can pipe it directly into this function, the Shapiro test. And as a note, if we wanted to look at that test and see what type of input it would take, we can bring up the help file. And when we come down to the arguments, we can see that the only argument that it takes is x and that that has to be a numeric vector. So here's where we can find out whether it will accept a data frame or whether it needs to be a vector or a matrix or something in a different class. This requires a vector, so we do need to do this process of pulling out and getting into a vector format the column that we want to test if we're starting from a data frame. All right, so we can pipe this in now. We get that nice printout, but again, something that might not be particularly useful to include later in a pipeline. And so as a last step here, we can do tidy from the Broom package, and that gets things back into a tibble, even if it's a small one of just one row, where we have this in a format where we really know what to do with it. This is exactly the format that we're working with for a lot of the tidyverse work that we've done so far. All right, so this is going through and showing that idea of adding on Shapiro test and then tidy to get back to the tidy format. And you'll notice in this chain, we're going from a data frame. This pull moves us into a vector since that's what we need for the test, but then we can run the test and then the tidy lets us get back to a data frame. So we've got this little piece in the middle where we move out of that data frame format, but then this lets us get back into it where we can use our classic tidyverse functions. All right, let's look at another example. In this case, let's look at some real data from an observation. And this is a pretty large data set that we'll use right now, just briefly, but then we'll use more in an extended example in just a minute. So we'll use it for something kind of simple right now, but then we'll do something more complex later in this chapter. This is from the microbiome library, and this actually comes from a different place than most of the packages that we've gotten so far. So this comes, we've been pulling most of our packages from CRAN, the comprehensive R archive network, but a lot of genomics and genomics related packages are stored on a different repository called Bioconductor. So if you search for Bioconductor, and then let's search for microbiome, that's the name of this package, you should get a link up that should take us right there. So if we go in, this is the page for that information, and you have to install these packages just a little bit of a different way if they're coming from Bioconductor. This code, if you copy and run it in your R session, will install the package for you. It might ask you if you want to update some packages when you do that. You can certainly do that, and you just type, it gives you options for all, some, or none, so you can just type the A for all of them. And then it often will give you the option of whether you want to build from source or just use binaries. And for those, I think it's going to be fine in most cases for what you're working on in this class, just to use the binaries. And that might be a little bit more quicker and require less setup on your computer. So you can choose, no, you don't want to install from source for that particular question when you run this. Once you have this, we can do the same process that we normally do. So you can do library microbiome. And then the name of this particular data set is Atlas 1006. So you can run that. And if you do the question mark, this data set does have a help file that comes with it. And it gives some different information about the data set, including a reference to a paper that describes the data. So this is data that's in a special class called a PhyloSeq class. This is a class that's used a lot for genomics and genomic style data in Bioconductor packages. And we can come down and we can take a look with class of Atlas 1600, and we could get that information there as well. Now it turns out that there are some functions that let us pull out and extract things from that special type of data. The get variable will let us pull out information about the study subjects. All right, so if we run that, we can see that we're getting a data frame where we've got information about these different samples that were run. And we've got information not about the measurements necessarily that they made for the microbiome for the samples, but things really about the subject. So we've got age, sex, nationality. We've got this diversity measurement, and we'll be looking at that in just a minute to see if it looks like it's normally distributed. And then some other information like the BMI group. So if they were underweight, lean, severely obese, these different categories related to obesity. We've also got the time, so some of these subjects were measured at different time points. So with this data, one thing that we might want to look at is this diversity measurement. And we might want to test and see if that diversity is different from characteristics of the subject, like their gender or nationality or some of the other factors. But to do that, we need to pick which statistical test to use, and we need to think about what assumptions would be reasonable for that diversity measurement. So it might be helpful for us to get a good idea of whether it looks like it's normally distributed or not. So again, this get variable lets us pull out the information from the larger and more complex Atlas 1006 data set. This pulls up as a data frame just the information about the different samples. And if we look at the number of rows, we can see that it's more than 1006. So it said that this was measurements on 1006 people, but it's got over 1100 rows. And that's because we've got this different sample time. So we can filter down to just places where this time's equal to zero. And then we'll be getting for everybody the measurement for their first kind of time point. So let's do filter. Now that we've gotten this as a data frame, we've pulled out this variable part from the larger PhiloSeq object type. We can do the different functions from tidyverse like filter. So we can say time equals zero, and this should filter us down just to the ones where they were measured at that first time point. And just to check, we can use nrow. And we can see now that we've got 1006, and that's what it tells us over here in the data that we have for our number of study subjects. So this looks like what we want to work for. Now, the next thing that we can do is we can do a visualization. We can do a histogram to take a look at this data and see if it looks like it's normally distributed. We have things in a data frame now, and so we can pipe directly into ggplot. In this case, we want to look at the diversity column. And then we want to do a histogram. So here's what that looks like, and we can see it certainly does not look like it's normally distributed. Just to check though, just to confirm, we can run that test. So we can do the same process that we were doing before. Again, the Shapiro-Wilk function will not allow us to put a data frame in. We need to just put in the vector of the values that we want to test. So we need to use that pull function to pull out just the diversity column as a single vector. And then the next step is we will run the test. So let's take a look at that. We can replace what we had here. So again, if we look at this piece, we could look maybe just at the top of that. So if we look right now, we've got all of these different columns, and right now what we're trying to test is for normality in this diversity column. So we can use pull to pull out diversity, and now we've got just that column as a vector. Now we can pipe that in to the Shapiro test. That gives us the output. We've got this p-value that's very, very small, much, much, much smaller than 0.05. So again, we're seeing a lot of evidence that we might want to reject the null in this case. Again, the null hypothesis is that the data are normally distributed. And then the last step we can do, again, to give this in a format we could work with more easily later, we can use the tidy function, and that will let the output that we get from this not be kind of like this list with the printout that's easy to read but hard to use for further stuff. In this case, when we add on tidy, it will give us the same information, but in a tuple that's easier for us to use later. So you can see now we've got the p-value and we've got the test statistic and the information about the method, but now it's in a tuple where we know how we can work with this data in the next steps we might want to do. All right, so this is my last slide on statistical tests. Next, we'll be going into statistical modeling with regression models. But this is the last piece I have about statistical tests. I again want to just give this reminder that this class is not a statistics class, and so we're not going to be talking any more about how you might pick which statistical tests you want to run. That's really something that you need to figure out by taking statistics classes or looking at statistical textbooks and other references like that. Once you know what test you want to run, then it's pretty easy to figure out the function that goes along with that test in R. A lot of times you can do that either, again, by looking things up in a statistics book or just by simply Googling the name of the statistical test and then R or R stats to see what that lines up with. There are some good books out there that can help you in figuring out some of the statistical parts, and many of them use R as the language for showing examples. One of them that we have at CSU available for free for students here is statistical analysis with R for Dummies, and that serves as a fine introduction to kind of get going and start exploring things as you go.